So, very good afternoon, respected chairpersons and dear colleagues. Today, I'm going to present a topic of our study, which has been done on intraocular lymphoma, and to assess the basically the precipitates, keratic precipitates that you see in lymphoma, and how is it different from true uveitic cases. So, as we know that intraocular lymphoma is a great masquerader. It masquerades infective, it masquerades inflammatory, and obviously other neoplastic entities. So, why it becomes very dangerous is because this intraocular lymphoma has a very insidious growth. As compared to CNS lymphoma, from the onset of symptoms of CNS lymphoma to its diagnosis is averagely 3 months. Whereas in a case of intraocular lymphoma, it's 1 year. And in that 1 year, it has varied of presentations where it presents to different ophthalmologists, undergoes various other treatment. So in the course of a intraocular lymphoma, patients of lymphoma have a lot of keratic precipitates. On a cursory examination, these keratic precipitates are very similar looking to those which occur in true uveitic entities. But if you look and examine clearly, closely, you see that these are not very similar. They are much, the KPs in intraocular lymphoma are larger. They are present throughout the corneal endothelium. They show no signs in change in shape and color as the disease progress. So with those thoughts in mind, we framed our research question. And the question was, can we use a non-invasive method like AIOC2020 and differentiate that modality between KPs which are in true uveitic and those in intraocular lymphoma? Can we use those to diagnose intraocular lymphoma earlier? And number two, how was this lymphoma morphology changing with intravitreal rituximab? That was our secondary aim. So we had an inclusion criteria. So cases which had positive vitreous cells, typical subretinal sub-RP presentations with positive biopsy were taken into cases. With no biopsy also patients were taken who had typical intraocular lymphoma, because as we know, sometimes biopsy in lymphoma can give a negative result. We excluded cases in which we had KPs, vitreous cells, but no typical posterior findings and no negative biopsy. So we had a prospective interventional study in which we divided patients into true uveitic and intraocular lymphoma. The lymphoma patients underwent a complete MRI brain and orbit, underwent biopsy, and depending on how whether the CNS disease was present or absent, they underwent only localized treatment or a general treatment. The grading was done for true uveitic according to sun classification, and then they underwent AIOC2020. The AIOC2020 module we used was Carl Zeiss, again with no financial interest, with an axial resolution of 5 and horizontal of 20 micrometers. We used the line and raster scan as well as the true protocol. We used 3 color maps, color, grayscale, and reverse grayscale. I'll come to these 3 later on in the next slide. So we had initially 15 patients, 30 eyes of intraocular lymphoma, which we suspected, but we excluded 6 patients in whom the biopsy was not satisfactory and which there was no typical lymphoma cells. We excluded 6 patients. So totally we had 9 patients with 18 eyes. The 4 patients had concurrent CNS disease during the presentation. Total of uveitic patients were 10 with idiopathic maximum of 6. So the bottom picture that you see is a typical, of intraocular lymphoma, which are large, white in color, and the note carefully the intervening area between the KPs. They are not regular. They have intervening spider web-like pattern. So the first AIOC2020 finding that we had was the morphology. The morphology was, it was large, it was smooth, and which was seen in the color, the top left, the gray scale, as well as reverse gray scale. All 3 maps showed the morphology to be large, as well as pretty smooth in contour. The second morphology that we saw was the intervening area. The intervening area was best studied by grayscale picture. So this grayscale picture was seen in all 100%. And the most important was the hyperreflective foci. This was seen best in the reverse grayscale, a center. So this is showing the treatment pre and post. Most important, as you see the bottom, the first to disappear is irregularity. And the most important that we see is accentuation of this hyperreflective foci on treatment with rituximab. We think this internal reflectivity to be internal lymphoma cells, which secondary incite an inflammatory response, which later on lead to secondary intervening web-like picture. This is the only study that we got which had a similar study done with us, and they also said that KPs they found were high reflectivity and KPs, but they did not see the role of rituximab. What we had a drawback was that we had not large number of cases because the presentation of lymphoma is rare. And the most important, we didn't study the individual KP to compare the histopathology of that KP to the clinical picture. So in the future, we like to have more number of patients with a multi-center approach, and we'd like to have a histopathological correlation of that KP to verify our theory that whether that hyperreflective foci that we are seeing on AIOC2020 is a lymphoma. Thank you so much.
How did you differentiate this from the inflammatory? Was there a difference in terms of
the inflammatory? Because lack of time, I didn't show the pictures. So in inflammatory cases, the area between the KPs were clear. There was no spider web-like appearance. The KPs were smaller in size, except those in granulomatous KPs. And all those KPs in granulomatous KPs also varied. Here, the large KPs are all in similar in size.
But your sample size was short.
Then.
But was there any significance statistically between the two, the control groups and the lymphoma?
The difference was that we didn't have any hyperreflective foci in the true uveitic. We didn't have any intervening irregularity of cornea in the true uveitic group, and the surface of the KPs were smaller. All eyes didn't show any such features.
Did you measure the size per se?
That is what we were in the, because since it is an ongoing study, that is our next, that we have, when we have large number of patients, we would like to study the individual size of the KPs and how do they reduce in size as we keep on giving treatment.
But on a comparative note, since you're comparing inflammation and this condition, would you know what would be the size of, in your current study, of the 10 patients as compared to the ones who are inflammatory?
Size managing? We have really not looked into, but we will definitely like to look into it in the future things.
What is the pre and post duration between the intravitreal rituximab? You have
so
taken the
scan. So we repeated every 2 weeks.
Every 2 weeks.
And we gave an average of 3 injections. And the only thing that we noted with intravitreal rituximab is the corneal epitheliopathy, which is more present with methotrexate rather than in rituximab. And the IOP was a major concern, but none of our 10 patients had any. All 10 patients received intravitreal rituximab. Even with CNS presentation, with unilateral, they had CNS systemic therapy along with focal treatment with intravitreal.
All patients were on topical steroids also?
No. Steroids were stopped 1 month before, biopsy. That is a strict protocol that we follow.
Karvi, I just wanted to tell you that nobody should go on with an idea that we can, based on the KPs, we are diagnosed as the intraocular lymphoma, because it's such a grave diagnosis. The treatment is so invasive. So in such cases, the biopsy would be the ultimate gold standard. And you should not really make a diagnosis by looking at the KP, whatever may be the size. It may look alike, and many of the KPs, until unless we really look into that control group and also disease control and come a specific conclusion, even then we should look for biopsy, histopathologic study.
Yes, sir. Biopsy is the gold standard. This is just a way which we thought a non-invasive procedure could help us diagnose earlier.
Announce this person.
Thank you.